HarperCollins presents The Power of Privilege, How White People Can Challenge Racism by June Sarpong. Read by June Sarpong. Dear listener, recent events around racial injustice have inspired many with agency and privilege in society to ask, what can I do? And how can I be an effective ally? We are way beyond the point of empty rhetoric. Our actions must embody our ideals. Equality must be designed by each and every one of us. The challenge may be great, but it certainly is not insurmountable. And we all have a part to play. This book will help to identify the capacity that you, the listener, has to build the fair and just society that the better part of ourselves knows to be possible. I'd like to personally thank you for embarking on this important journey of positive change with me. There will be some uncomfortable moments, but getting comfortable with being uncomfortable is a major first step in making a real difference. Thank you. The Polarized Present. The white man's happiness cannot be purchased by the black man's misery. Frederick Douglass. Racism. Racism is the belief that people of some races are inferior to others, and the behavior which is the result of this belief. Racism also refers to the aspects of a society which prevent people of some racial groups from having the same privileges and opportunities as people from other races. Collins English Dictionary. Anti-racism. Anti-racism is an active and conscious effort to work against multidimensional aspects of racism. Robert J. Patterson. Other. Noun. A person of a marginalized or excluded group or demographic within society. Otherize or otherizing, verb. To exclude or facilitate the exclusion of an individual or group through action or inaction. Otherism, noun. A conscious or unconscious bias that is formed through ignorance or conditioning that results in beliefs or actions that exclude individuals or groups deemed different or other. Otherizing happens when our brains make incredibly quick judgments and assessments of people and situations, often without us realizing. Our prejudices are influenced by our background, culture, and personal experiences. Without us actively exploring and challenging our limiting beliefs, we can be inadvertently complicit in fueling inequality. Diversify.org. As a child growing up on a council estate in London's East End, I can remember my Ghanaian immigrant parents drumming into me the idea that I was going to need to work twice as hard for half as much. I don't remember ever asking them, work twice as hard for half as much as who? And they never explicitly stated who the who was. They didn't need to. The signs were everywhere. From my young impressionable eyes, I could see for myself that everything that represented power and privilege was white, primarily white and male, and the opposite of me. This is a conversation that every child of colour raised in the West will have had with their parents or caregivers. They might not recall when they first had the conversation, but they will remember having had it. For non-white children growing up as minorities in Europe or North America, the first uncomfortable conversation with their parents isn't about the birds and the bees. That comes much later. Much more pressing matters come first, the harsh realities of the discrimination that is likely to impact them the moment they leave the safety of their parents' home and enter the world. White children have the luxury of waiting until their tweens before having to learn about the realities of life. Sadly, children of colour are told much earlier, and their conversation is about the inequities they will invariably face at some point, no matter how talented or brilliant they might be. I describe in the foreword of the British edition of Black Enough, Ibi Zoboe's book of short stories for teens, that this is a heartbreaking burden that parents of colour, or white parents of non-white children, have to bear. Children of mixed race heritage are one of the fastest growing ethnic groups in Britain, and this is a rapidly increasing trend in the USA too. So now many parents who might not themselves have a lived experience of discrimination are having to have the conversation. The conversation meant I didn't complain when my parents berated me for my less than A-star report card, or for my tardiness, or corrected my grammar, spelling, or mispronunciations, even though they had heavy African accents themselves. They demanded that their children speak the Queen's English, because the stakes were higher for me. I wasn't on a level playing field. No, it wasn't fair, but it was the reality. And I had to make the most of the hand I'd been dealt. My parents' journey to the UK had not been an easy one, so in comparison to all that they had experienced, my dose of inequality did not seem worthy of complaint. There were no excuses. No matter what, they still expected the best from me and my siblings. The only problem was that inequality meant second-generation immigrant kids like me might not actually be given the opportunity to be able to do our best. My first book, Diversify, examined the social, moral, and economic benefits of diversity and explained why inclusive societies are better for everyone. While promoting Diversify, I found myself traveling all over the world, having conversations around the sorts of prickly subjects we are supposed to avoid in polite company. Subjects such as gender, class, sexual orientation, race, and religion. I mediated while those from both underrepresented and privileged groups engaged in difficult yet brutally honest and open dialogue. I listened while people bravely voiced their concerns, hurts, frustrations, confusion, shame, and guilt. I was heartened and humbled by the sorts of breakthroughs I saw take place between friends, families, colleagues, and even strangers. The kind of understanding I witnessed made me more hopeful than ever, even in such divisive times. However, even with these breakthroughs, wherever I went, there was an ever-present elephant in the room: the role of the main beneficiaries of our unfair system, white people, particularly privileged white men. The concept of privilege. The concept of privilege can be a challenging one to get across, but it's one of the key factors that has shaped the inequalities, imbalances, and prejudices of society today. In order to fix the problem, the first step is acknowledging it. Nicholas Connolly. The term white privilege has become a part of the common lexicon, but what does it actually mean? And how does it play out in real life? And how can you become aware of it if you are one of its beneficiaries? In her famed 1989 essay, White Privilege, Unpacking the Invisible Knapsack, American scholar and anti-racism activist Peggy McIntosh brilliantly describes her breakthrough in fully understanding this concept and all that it affords her. I think whites are carefully taught not to recognize privilege, as males are taught not to recognize male privilege. So I've begun in an untutored way to ask what it is like to have white privilege. I have come to see white privilege as an invisible package of unearned assets, which I can count on cashing in each day, but about which I was meant to remain oblivious. It's so important that those afforded privilege no longer remain oblivious. This is not about shame or guilt, and certainly not about superiority or pity either. It's about understanding this elevated position and exploring the concept of privilege, the systemic benefits universally accrued to members of the majority group. The late US academic Alan G. Johnson spent much of his working life explaining and challenging this concept. In a blog post titled, What is a System of Privilege? Johnson describes privilege as being organized around three principles: dominance, identification, and centeredness. For example, a system of white privilege through being white dominated results in white people almost always occupying societal positions of power. A person of color inhabiting this position is consequently seen to be an exception. White dominance, Johnson explains, can be seen in Barack Obama being described as the black president, not just the president. This white-dominated society further leads to white identification, through which white people begin to be identified as the norm. Everyone who falls outside of this category, often people of color, are defined by what they are not, non-white, rather than what they are. It would be strange for one group of people to be set as the standard for all humans without there being a reason for it. And so society constructs the most logical explanation that white people are the norm because they are to be seen as superior, as Johnson goes on to explain. Several things follow from this, including seeing the way they do things as simply human or normal and giving more credibility to their views than to the views of others. And in this case, people of color. White identification also encourages whites to be unaware of themselves as white, as if they didn't have a race at all. It also encourages whites to be unaware of white privilege. These two principles, combined with white-centeredness, putting white people in the center of attention, from newspapers and books to films and TV, result in white people being afforded unprecedented amounts of opportunity an advantage simply because they are white. How to reimagine a future where the rest of society is afforded the same access to the opportunity that has been the private domain of privileged white men for so long is a question that has long perplexed those of us on the inclusion mission, along with how to honestly call out inequality without demonizing the very group that has the tightest grip on the levers of prosperity. The data is clear. White men account for 72% of corporate leadership in Fortune 500 companies surveyed. And in the UK, there are only 6 female heads of FTSE 100 companies. So if more equality in the workplace and beyond is the goal, then white men need to be involved. But what can the group who have the most agency in society do to affect long-lasting positive change? What can the group whose ancestors created the current imbalance we live under do to help create a new, more inclusive normal and perhaps help correct some of the wrongs of the past? In this book, I aim to answer these questions as best I can, as well as offering 10 concrete actions that people of privilege can undertake to make things better. Though I have so far mainly mentioned privileged white men, there is also an incredibly important role for allies across the board, particularly white women. Amongst the groups representing those of diverse characteristics, white women from affluent backgrounds undoubtedly are those with the most agency in society and are likely to have the closest proximity to their white male equivalents, who are in the most privileged group. This enables white women of privilege to be powerful allies for any of the other groups. Because of the sheer number of those impacted, gender equality as an inclusion discussion is usually led by white women. But there is an easy opportunity here to display inclusion by highlighting intersectional aspects of gender, such as race, and sharing platforms with other groups of women marginalized by additional characteristics of exclusion. Having an understanding of discrimination based on gender, white women have an opportunity to empathize and build coalitions between a range of diverse groups, using their position in the power structure to build bridges. It is also important to note that as we strive towards gender parity, I do not assume that all white men have privilege, not for one second. Of course, race and sex are physical characteristics that can easily be recognized on sight and used to positively or negatively classify an individual, depending on how similar or different they are from the norm. However, even individuals who have the elevated characteristics of being male and white may also be denied the level of agency that often flows from that association. Obviously, the lived experience of working class or low-income white males greatly differs from that of elite or privileged white men, as does the experience of white women of differing socioeconomic backgrounds. This is something we have witnessed in recent years with the rise of forgotten white working class males who are not succeeding in state schools and who, as a result of globalization, are losing their traditional manual and semi-skilled occupations. This, ironically, is due more often than not to more affluent, more educated white men outsourcing jobs abroad and creating innovations in technology that undermine traditional working class jobs. These economic shifts have placed the white males who rely on manual work at a disadvantage to educated non-whites and women who are more able to attain or develop the skills needed.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.